If you're a Texas landowner and you're interested in improving the quality of the genetics on your ranch, you can contact me at deerandwildlifestories.com. Howdy everybody, my name is Keith Warren and welcome to Deer and Wildlife Stories, where this week we'll be heading north to the Hoosier state of Indiana, and we'll introduce you to the folks over at the Indiana Deer Farmers Association, and at the same time be visiting three Indiana deer farms. As a deer hunter, I want to know all I can about America's favorite big game animal. That's why I became a deer farmer. Without deer farms, we lose our greatest resource for research and whitetail management. With them, we gain more knowledge than ever before. Join me as we discover the truth about whitetails and meet those who work every day to preserve this great species for future generations. My name is Keith Warren, and this is Deer and Wildlife Stories. Any serious whitetail enthusiast knows that the state of Indiana has got some giant whitetail deer. And the folks with the Indiana Deer Farmers Association are leading the way with growing the biggest whitetail deer in the state.
I'm Chris Ezell, a deer farmer from Oklahoma. I also own a lot of deer in Indiana. Every year, the Indiana Deer Farmers Association has an annual picnic, and we'll have between 400 and 500 people show up. What makes the Indiana deer market so special is that they are able to sell deer to just about every state in the United States. The main thing that I enjoy about the picnic is it is the best food of any deer convention or anything that you will go to anywhere. One of the great things about this event is anyone can come, anyone's welcome. You don't have to be a deer farmer, just a deer lover, deer hunter, or anything else in between. The event is held in August each year, and we would love to see you there. For more information on this event, log on to indianadeerfarmers.com.
All right, so on this part of the show, we are just outside of Grable, Indiana. It's in the northern part of Indiana, and these does right here are some of the most valuable does in the deer industry. I'm at Springfield Whitetails, and the owner of Springfield Whitetails is named Lester Eicher. Now, Lester is an Amishman. This is Amish country, and Lester cannot be on camera, so he's asked me to do this for him. On this part of the program, we're gonna tour Springfield Whitetails. We're gonna show you a whole bunch of deer, but I wanna introduce you to one special deer. His name is the Fed, and the Fed is a deer that everybody in the deer industry is talking about, and I think you're gonna see why. So today I brought in LE Fence. The reason why is because these guys know how to not only build a fantastic fence, but also work around deer. And it's important because you want those deer to remain calm when you're building fence around them. Okay, it may sound crazy, but we just stuck up a fence in a deer pen to keep the deer a little bit more calm. That's the first thing. Believe it or not, if you have a big deer pen, deer have a lot of room to run around. So a small pen keeps the deer more calm. But also a smaller pen allows me to control the population a little bit better. You know, deer multiply rapidly. And one of the problems that most deer breeders have is they have an overpopulation problem. And so by having a smaller pen, it allows me to control the animals better. It allows them to be more gentle. And it just helps with the overcrowding issue, big time. Just another day on the farm. The Deer Farming Channel is brought to you in part by Record Rack Deer and Elk Feeds. All right, so I need your help answering this one. You're going to be good at this.
Uh-oh.
Okay, so, all right. Gerald wants to know, why is it that some breeders wait to breed a great yearling buck while others wait until they're older? What's the advantage?
I don't feel there's no advantage. I think the advantage is to get them out as soon as you can.
To prove the deer.
That's right.
What we need to do as deer farmers, if these are your genetics, okay, if they're your genetics, mm-hmm. you should be proud of them. I mean, anybody would be proud of the rock. But when you start taking a look at this, I think if you're not proud enough and believe in your genetics enough to breed them as yearlings, then you're probably doing the wrong thing.
Yeah, I want fawns on the ground the first year, and every one of them would be registered right off the bat.
Yep, so every one of them's in the North American Deer Registry. Right. Gerald, that's a great question. If y'all have a question, get a hold of me on my website and hit the Connect with Keith tab. So if you're watching Deer and Wildlife Stories last year, you watched us go to the Northern Top 30 sale. And at that Northern Top 30, there were a lot of real expensive deer that sold, but the most expensive deer that sold came off of this farm. Now that doe was the highest selling doe in the entire Top 30 Northern auction. And that's saying something, because all the folks that are at this auction are there for one thing, to buy the best deer that they can find. So not only does Lester have fabulous does, but he's also got fabulous bucks. And one of them happens to be a three-year-old. His name is the Fed. So you may be wondering, what does the pedigree of the Fed look like? Well, let me mention the name FedEx, okay? Anybody in the deer industry knows FedEx. FedEx, we just videoed him the other day. At 8 years old, he's 30 inches wide, 30 inch plus main beams. He's one of the biggest, most beautiful, most proven bucks out there. And so the Fed, his daddy, is FedEx. Now, as you look at him, I want to tell you something. As 3 years old, you're going to look at this deer and go, holy smokes, when are they going to start breeding him? Well, Lester took a gamble when the Fed was only a year old. And the reason why is because the Fed was unbelievable. If you take a look at the picture of him as a yearling and you see these beams on him, you see all the antler, Lester took a gamble. Now, most deer breeders will not breed with a yearling. And the reason why is they want to wait till he turns two. The reason why we've seen a lot of big yearlings kind of go south by the time from one to two. But Lester gambled, and that gamble paid off, because by the time he hit two, the Fed was giant. But the good thing is he had fawns on the ground. So now the Fed is three. Look at him. And the cool thing about the Fed is now he has yearling bucks on the ground, which prove his performance. And I want to point something out. Now Lester's in Northern Indiana. Hey baby, how you doing? And a lot of people in Indiana are breeding with the Fed. But the cool deal about this deer, the Fed, there's people from Texas. You got Alan Meyer down in Texas. Alan has got a pile of over 200 inch yearlings out of the Fed. All right, then you got Gary Edwards up in Michigan. Gary is one of the most well-known, longest deer breeders in the entire state of Michigan. And Gary's got one of the biggest yearlings he's ever had. Then you got down in Oklahoma, Braden Wright. Braden Wright, out of the Fed, has got the biggest yearling they have ever had. So as you look at the Fed at 3 years old, you got to know that he's already proven. That production is proven. And if you're interested in buying some semen from Lester Eicher at Springfield Whitetails right here in Northern Indiana, you can contact Lester at 260-341-3614. Go ahead and give him a call. He'd love to hear from you. Coming up next, we're heading north, just up the road, and we'll show you some great big deer up there too. If you're in Texas and interested in becoming a deer farmer, you can contact me for deer farming franchise opportunities right here in Texas at deerandwildlifestories.com. All right, it's breakfast time, September the 1st. Bottle raising a fawn this late in the summer, we don't really like doing it, but sometimes we have to. This fawn was born August the 1st, and that's late in the summer. The mother didn't want to take care of it, so we decided to make sure, pull it in so it'd be nice and healthy. Another good reason to pull it in was because it's 90 days to wean a fawn. If this fawn was born August the 1st, it'd be November the 1st before that mother had it weaned off, and that's not enough time to get it in good shape to breed again for the following fall. So there's reasons why we pull fawns to bottle feed. Late born fawns, we especially want them off so the mothers get in better shape to breed come fall. Just another day on the farm. All right, so we leave Springfield Whitetails and we're gonna head down to central Indiana to a deer farm owned by my friend, Doug McCombs. Now, Doug is an interesting guy, to say the least. And for a new deer farmer, he's got some great deer.
Hi, Doug McComb. I'm the owner here at Camelot Ridge Resort in beautiful Villa, Indiana. And we've got about 100 deer here behind the fence. We've got a number of them, probably 40 right here in the pens alone, and we're gonna go down and take a look at them.
So if somebody would have told you 10 years ago that you're going to be doing this today, what would you have said?
I don't think so.
Pretty amazing, isn't it?
Yes, it is. It was just supposed to be a hobby. These are some yearling bucks that we have. If you can imagine, a year ago, they were just babies getting fed.
So realizing Doug is a relatively new deer breeder, I couldn't wait to get down to the pens and see what he had. And little did I know, I was in for a surprise, because he had a certain kind of deer that most deer breeders have never thought about having.
Yeah, we've got a nice assortment of some big gnarly deer. We've got one right there, Skipper. He's a mule deer, half mule deer.
So why did you do the mule deer program?
We just decided that it would be something interesting for us, keep our skills sharp here, and for the public to see, and just kind of keep perpetuating this and see if we can get bigger and better.
All right, so one of the things that Doug has done different here is he's got mule deer hybrids, and I want to point something out to you that it's kind of unusual. There are some people doing it. I've been doing it for about 10 years. And if you take a look at it, you can tell through the antlers and through the face, if you look at enough deer, if they've got a little bit of mule deer in them. But that's a 50% mule deer whitetail cross. But I want to show you something that will be a dead giveaway that you can tell it's got mule deer in it. If you take a look at the glands on the back legs, okay, on a mule deer, the glands are elongated. And on a whitetail, they're not. I mean, you can take a look at this guy's face and you can tell it's a little bit different. He's got a little bit larger ears than a whitetail's got. And you think, okay, he's probably got a little bit of mule deer in him. But when you start taking a look at the back legs, the gland on the back legs being elongated signifies it does have mule deer in it. Okay, a white-tailed deer, their glands on the back legs are very, very small. So this is pretty cool. I look at it as kind of like a research project. So like any new deer farmer, Doug, well, he's enthusiastic as he can be. I mean, just look at him. You know, he's talking, he's always smiling, he's jolly, and he's stoked, and he ought to be. You know, his deer look really good, but there's one deer, one buck I'm looking at, and I'm thinking, that guy is a toad. And it turns out that he's the son of a buck by the name of the Fed. Now, the Fed is located just up the road in Indiana, and it's owned by a guy by the name of Lester Eicher. And Lester has got this buck. He's a three-year-old, and there's nothing wrong with the Fed. You take a look at him, you think, holy smokes, he's got it all. And the buck right here on Doug's place is the son of the Fed. So Doug's following the recipe to success, and that's starting with quality, quality, quality. And he's dealt with Lester Eicher. And most of the deer on his farm are from Lester's farm. And that's the way new deer breeders get set up. They deal with somebody, number one, that they trust, and number two, that's got really, really good genetics. And so you know when you look at Doug's herd, he's got it made because he started with the right genetics. So this is really important. As a deer breeder, when people get in the deer breeding industry, I say, you know, which side of the industry do you want to be on? Do you want to be on the breeding side, or do you want to be on the pasture deer side? And that's real important for you to know, because in some markets, like the Texas market, I mean, there's a lot of people on the breeding side. They're breeding for nothing but the best of the best of the best genetics. But let's face it, there's only about 3% of the deer that are going to be in that breeder genetic pool. The other 97% of the deer are in what we call the pasture deer pool. Okay, and those pasture deer, they've got fantastic genetics. They just aren't breeder deer. So in Indiana, most of the market is on the pasture deer side, and there's nothing wrong with that. They may not be big enough to actually use for breeder bucks in somebody's breeder pen, but they're big enough to put on these big pieces of property to take those genetics and spread those genetics through the herd, and that will improve the property value on any piece of property.
Deer have brought tremendous value to this property, as any other property anywhere. People love wildlife. People especially love deer. You have deer, rather it's in a preserve, or you have deer, rather they're wild and you're cultivating it with crops, with food plots and whatnot, you're gonna enhance and add to the value of your land.
So leaving Doug's place, we're gonna head south, down to the Indiana-Kentucky state line to a fellow by the name of Jeff Eastridge. Now Jeff's got a deer on his place that is shaking up the entire industry. This is a yearling buck, folks, and he's a son out of the deer that Lester had that we showed you called the Fed. The Deer Farming Channel is brought to you in part by New Dart, leading the industry in accuracy.
My name is Jeff Eastridge, and welcome to Stewart Creek Whitetails.
And we're going to introduce you to one of the biggest yearlings I've ever seen. His name is The Rock.
Look at that bad boy. Woo! Oh my gosh. All right, where do you normally go in to feed at right here?
All right, so when I found out about this buck, The Rock, everybody's been talking about him. I wound up, I got a picture on my cell phone. I was like, holy smokes, I gotta come. And so we're at Stewart Creek Whitetails out of New Albany, Indiana. This is in the southern part of Indiana. And Jeff has not been breeding deer all that long to have a deer like this. How long have you been breeding them?
2016.
Wow. And so yes. When all of a sudden this deer pops up, I mean, you got to be blown away, just like everybody in the industry is. Tell me about him. First off, tell me about his pedigree.
Well, he's a FedEx son on Red Hot, and it goes back to Kingspan Dane.
Well, he's got a really, really stout pedigree, but just take a look at that look. And folks, could you imagine being in the deer industry 3 years and being able to pop out a buck like that? Now, you know, I'm just curious, as I look at him, I'm thinking, at what point? Now, he was born here, right?
Yes, he was.
Okay, and I want to point this out. Jeff has that buck's mom and his sister here in that pen right over there. So that tells you something. Okay, and so he's going to be breeding the mom and sister right, but he's going to be breeding The Rock right too. At what point did you realize that he was going to be a special deer?
Probably about 2 months ago. You know, he's just really started putting on some antler, and so I talked to a few guys here in the last couple weeks, and then found out about the TDA there in Texas, and got me a plane ticket and went to Texas.
Yeah, so what happened, Jeff shows up at the TDA, and of course I was there, of course, and he's showing this deer off to people. Of course, most of those people already seen it because I'd send them pictures. Said, you need to check out The Rock, you need to check out The Rock. It's like, ooh. And so anyway, he's got a lot of attention going on. But this deer right here, I mean, as a yearling, what are your plans to do with him? Because, and the reason why I ask that is because there's a lot of people out there that have real big yearlings, but they will not do anything with them for various reasons, okay? They just don't decide to breed with them. What are your plans with him?
Oh, I'm most definitely going to breed with him and sell semen. Yes, he's 7/8 brother to the Fed, which is really putting a bunch of great yearlings out this year. Oh, yeah. And we have one of him as well. And just one of the prettiest typicals you can see, I've ever seen. And so anyway, we're gonna put him out there. We're gonna breed him and sell semen.
Well, I want to tell you, the reason why I prefaced that question the way I did was, what are you gonna do with him? Because there's a lot of people that wind up having big yearlings, but at two, they just don't pan out for whatever reason. They just kind of peter out. There may be, I want to point out all these other yearlings in this pen, there's some extraordinary nice yearlings. And one of them may blow up at two, but I don't think that they're going to be able to keep up with The Rock. The Rock is unbelievable. So a lot of people, what they'll wind up doing is just not breed a big yearling. And I think that it's a mistake, okay? I mean, let's talk about a buck, the Fed. The Fed is from Indiana, and I mean, Lester wound up, took a gamble on him, yes, and bred him heavy as a yearling. And there are people, yes, in Texas all the way to Michigan with great big yearling bucks out of the Fed. And now the Fed has proven himself, so the value is up, okay? And so what you're going to do with The Rock is prove him.
That's right.
You're going to get that semen out there and people, deer all over the country, and 2 years from now, when those yearling bucks are on the ground and he's three, we're gonna be able to show you what The Rock looks like at three and also the production out of him. But the important thing to point out here is that the does, that you've got his sister and his mother,
yes,
right there. And
yes,
that is such a wonderful foundation for a guy that's only been breeding deer since 2016. So
yes,
if somebody wants more information about buying semen, buying some offspring out here, or coming out and taking a look at your place, give them a telephone number.
My cell phone number is 502-376-1583.
And I'm going to tell you, we wound up, we came out here, I thought, okay, we're going to do like a normal deer and wildlife story. We went in the barn and we got the grandkids and Jeff bottle feeding, and we kind of hung around and all. We were going to do it normally, but it's like, wait a minute, we can't do a normal segment. And the reason why, because that is not a normal deer. That is a unusual deer. He's so big. And so I'm thinking, I'm very excited to be able to have the opportunity to share this deer with y'all and to share Jeff's story with you, because that right there is a dream come true for a guy that's been breeding deer for as short a period as you, huh?
Yes. The it's funny because the brochure I made up to take to Texas with me, I put on the very top yearling, okay? So when I handed it out, it's kind of just to get the feel from what people thought. And everybody's like, man, it's a nice two-year-old.
Well, okay, that's what did I tell you? Yeah. Okay, tell him what I told you.
Yeah, he told me you didn't put on there his age. Well, I did at the top, very small yearling.
And I said, but you might need to make it what? Big.
Right. But everybody got it, and it was like, you know, and they was like, well, that's a beautiful two-year-old. And I said, it's a yearling.
Yeah, yeah. So, folks, if y'all want more information, you can hold Jeff. And I'd like to tell you thanks for watching the show. If you have any questions or comments, you know how to get a hold of me. My name is Keith Warren, and thanks for watching Deer and Wildlife Stories.